You should have received an email yesterday about the next quest. It's four short questions on adsorption, and it's due Sunday evening at midnight. So you've got 3-4 days to get to that still. And then once that one's done, there'll be one final one which will cover this topic of drive. So that way you've got extra practice problems for the exam other than the tutorial. Because the problem is this material right at the end, you don't have enough practice on it. So it's just some quick questions to get going. Okay, so today's class, we're going to consider drying of solids. And maybe I just want you to think of this as a concept quick. So, end of exams, you're out partying 2 a.m. in the morning, you get into your car, you're the designated driver, unfortunately, or fortunately. And you're taking four of your friends. You all get into the car, and the first thing that happens, being a cold winter's night, is that your windshield fogs up. Yeah? What do? You turn on the AC, you turn on the heat, you crank open the windows, you place your friends out of the car. No, you don't want to wipe. So, do you turn up the heat, do you turn up the AC? So, if you want the fog to disappear the fastest, AC or the heat?
AC.
Okay. So, let's take a look. We'll get to that. Now, when we're drying solids, this is typical drying profiles that we see for solids. It's pretty complex. So, as I said in an earlier class, we do not model this from first principles, but what we do notice is if we take some solid with moisture, we can easily track this moisture profile over time. The y-axis over here is measuring the mass of water per mass of dry solid. That's very easy. You put your solid on a scale, you know what your mass of dry solid is, and you can see this profile of that decreasing over time. Now, what happens is that there's four distinct zones from a conceptual point of view. Just as you're starting to heat your material, it's not at the temperature of your heating air. So there'll be a very short period of time where you have to heat up your environment to be coming to get close to where evaporation starts to occur. So a little bit of moisture will fall off here between A and B. Okay, and this period of time is typically pretty short. So this graph is emphasized, it's not typical profile for any solid. And also the other thing is that these are not necessarily equally spaced. So it looks like A to B to C to D is the same duration time. On many solids, it's actually quite different. But the part we're interested in today is this DC section. DC is what's called the constant drying rate, the constant rate of drying. Okay, so in other words, the slope from B to C is constant slope. And we'll reach a critical point C. So what happens in that region from B to C visually, if you can look in at the solids and the moisture, you've got this moisture at the surface, here's your heat being applied above, that liquid is being vaporized, and these white pieces here, the solid, show that this liquid is moving up through the solid to the surface. So liquid is constantly being supplied. That's not limiting your drying rate. The drying rate is purely limited by how fast you can move this moisture from liquid to vapor. That's what's limiting you. But the liquid coming from the interior of the solid to the surface is constant. You'll get to a point, though, where you start to deplete most of the water, and then here's where we see our drying rate falling off. This happens intuitively, you can understand it, because simply there isn't as much surface area of moisture available. So the rate at which you remove that moisture falls off. Until eventually the solid, there's very little moisture left, and in fact that moisture doesn't permeate up to the top, and then you have really, really slow rate of drying occur. Now, for many systems, the section from B to C is for most of the profile. C is actually far down here, C and D are pretty close to each other. So many systems, B and C, that distance, like constant moisture Sorry, concentrated drawing is where you spend most of your time. So that's a conceptual viewpoint we have. And as I said, we're going to focus on the B2C section of the system. So what we can state then mathematically, let's say our water flux is the mass of water we remove per unit time per unit area. And if we put some symbols to that, water flux is mass of water removed. So if we go back to this plot over here, X here represents my water fraction, mass of water per mass of dry solid. X is mass of water per mass dry solid. We're going to use this formula later again. So that's X, and if I want to plot the water flux, mass of water, water flux then is equal to, if I want to differentiate that, dx by dt, that's the rate at which I remove water per unit time, per unit area. And ms then is the mass of dry solid. So I eliminate mass of dry solid from the denominator by multiplying by ms. So that's some notation we're going to use. And our assumption is, and it's a good assumption, is that we're limited only by how fast we can vaporize that water. Okay, the solid is not limiting us. The solid is able to bring that moisture from the interior up to the surface fast enough, much faster than you're able to evaporate. And if we have that occurring, and we're assuming that all the heat we're putting into the system goes only to vaporizing the liquid, by that I mean that none of the heat is going to heating up the solids. So the solid is at a temperature, all of the heat only goes to vaporizing. Then we can equate our heat flux and then this moisture flux multiplied by delta HVAP. So we saw that actually yesterday in the spray dryer. One point in the voiceover, the guy was saying, spray dryers, even though you've got this very high temperature heat around your solid never gets scorched, was I think the word he used. Because what happens is that the heat is only going to vaporizing. By the time that particle is dried, it's fallen to the bottom. So none of the excess heat being provided goes to heating up the solid. All the heat goes to vaporizing the liquid. So if we recall, delta HVAP is the heat of vaporization. That has units of joules of heat per kilogram. Heat of vaporization per kilogram of solid, we multiply it by the moisture flux, so the mass of water, then that energy that's being supplied is going to vaporization. So moisture flux we have from the previous slide over there, multiplied by heat of vaporization. The only term we don't have yet is heat flux. Heat flux is how fast our heat is coming towards the solid. So at the solid boundary, we've got moisture going from liquid to vapor. That's my mass flux. But then I've got heat coming in. How do we quantify that? Well, heat flux as any principle in engineering, where we have a flux occurring, there's a driving force and a resistance. The driving force is the temperature difference. So here's my solid. And the vaporization is occurring here at the boundary. And at the boundary, that's my wet bulb temperature, TW. So wet bulb temperature. And in the bulk phase, I have my dew point temperature. So it's this difference between the dew point temperature and the wet bulb temperature. That's my driving force. The wider I can make those temperatures apart, the greater the heat being transferred. So either I can bring in a temperature stream of higher temperature, sorry, an air stream of higher temperature, higher dew point. This is going to usually be the same. The wet bulb temperature stays constant. But if I bring in a hotter air stream, I can dry that solid a lot faster.
Why does it have a dB in it? It has a dB.
Oh, yeah.
That's a dB.
Oh. You're absolutely right. It's, sorry, I will submit mix up my D's, P's, and D's. Okay, so let me clear this up. So D, B, and not D point. Thank you very much, because that would be totally the wrong derivation. Dry ball. It's a terrible habit. I also get my left and right mixed up. So okay, left and right, DB, DP, it's dry bulb temperature. That's my driving force, and wet bulb, and I've got this one right. So my driving force then is what's the thermometer that I hold up in the air. That's my dry bulb. This wet bulb temperature is a temperature that where this evaporation is occurring at. The wider those are apart, the greater my heat flux. Okay, now you're starting to see the answer to the air conditioner problem in your car. Okay, so the greater that temperature difference, the faster the heat being transferred. That heat is all going to vaporize in the liquid, and so then I will get a greater mass flux, greater evaporation from the liquid onto into the vapor.
Forgetting the heat.
Sorry?
Is the heat goes faster?
We'll answer that in a minute. You're still worried about that. So we've got this driving force. That's all our driving force is this temperature difference. There's always a resistance. The resistance in this case is the heat transfer coefficient. So we express our resistances as inverses, so 1 over h here. And that h we can derive from correlations. So I'll show you some correlations for that in a minute. So I now have some symbols here, notation for my heat flux, and I have symbols and notation for my moisture flux, and I can equate those two, and we get a derivative ODE equation that we can integrate here. So the mass of water evaporated per unit time as a function of those constants, of those symbols over there. Now, not all of them are constants, so that's what we're going to check next. If we do this integral, and we bring over the derivative of the mass of water being evaporated over to the left, and we put time over the right, everything in this integral could potentially vary with time. So what varies with time and what stays constant? In that constant rate period, if we're considering only this period from B to C, so we said during that period of time, we have constant rate drying. In this integral, what symbols remain constant and won't change with time? Heat transfer coefficient H. Okay, area remains constant. Heat transfer coefficient H remains constant. Dry bulb temperature. That remains constant. We're providing a stream of warm air at a constant dry bulb temperature. Wet bulb temperature. Should remain constant. It's the temperature at which this evaporation is occurring. So this temperature at the surface, remember our heat is coming in and it's only being used to vaporize that liquid. So that's, as long as that's occurring, that temperature at the interface remains constant. Heat of vaporization, is that changing with time? Heat of vaporization is only a function of temperature. Okay, so as our temperatures remain constant, HVAP stays constant. So in fact, all those terms can be brought outside the integral, and we end up with the last equation.
Is that only during that period of time?
During the BTC. Okay, so time to remove water then is a function of these terms over here. So we can remove water faster, evaporate faster, if we have less water to evaporate, that's obvious. If the heat of vaporization is small, then the time to vaporize that water is short. And so some substances have a very small delta HVAP. They require very little heat to take them from the liquid to vapor form. So the time to vaporize that is less. Heat transfer coefficient, we're going to see how to vary that. Do we want to increase or decrease this? We want to make that as high as possible, so we get short times. Area, we want to increase, okay, so you'll see that coming up in the case study. And this difference here, you want to make as wide as possible.
Wait, how do you change the dry bulb?
Yeah, you can change the dry bulb temperature. Okay, so let's take a look at some of those heat transfer coefficients. There's it's quite interesting, they're derived in such a way that they're actually independent of the type of solid you're drawing. Yes?
How difficult does it get to model when you're past that sequence? So you start to actually dry it out and there's no little or less liquid in it.
Right. In a batch system, it's quite easy to monitor for that because you suddenly see your temperatures rise because now your heat's not going anymore into it's being used to be used up to vaporize the liquid. You could maintain constant temperatures. So the moment you see your temperatures rise, means your heat's not being used up anymore to vaporize the liquid.
Okay. So all of your energy is going to removing that liquid from the solid and not actually heating the solid up.
Right.
Just so you start heating the solid up.
There's more heat remaining in the dryer. In fact, commercial systems, that's how they monitor when they've reached their end point, is they're monitoring those temperatures. The moment they see a rise, they cut. So let's take a look at the heat transfer coefficients. H, they're modeled as a function of things that you would expect. If you increase the velocity of the airflow, you should get a higher heat transfer coefficient. So faster moving air, you can remove that moisture faster. And in fact, the equation is given in terms of this new number G. So we'll look at the units of G here in a minute. G here is actually a mass flux of air, or mass flow of air. So it's kilograms of air per hour per meter squared is what the correlations require G to be in. So that's the reason is because these correlations use G and they require G's denominator to be hours, not per second. So we have to use non-SI units here for G, and that explains the 3,600. But otherwise, the density of the air multiplied by the velocity would give you the mass flow of the air. So once we calculate G for a known velocity and a known density, well, what's density of this air mixture? We derived this yesterday and we called it humid volume. So yesterday we had a term up there called VH. VH is 1 over the density. It's the inverse of it. So density is easy to get. Humid volume, if you recall yesterday, VH is a function of psi and a function of the dry volume. Temperature. Okay, so we know that. Those two entries, so we can calculate the density of the air. The velocity of the air is straightforward to measure. So we can estimate G. And once we have G, we can use these correlations. And the correlations depend on how we feed our air. So if we feed our air parallel flow to the surface, we're drying, then we use this correlation. And if we're feeding our air perpendicular to the solids we're drying, then we use a different correlation. Okay, and then there's other correlations still if your solids are pelletized and so forth. So all of these two correlations on the slide mean that you're drying like a slab of solid over here, and you're either passing your air parallel or you're passing your air vertically and impinging at a perpendicular angle onto that solid. So that's these two correlations here. And they make sense. Increase that velocity, you'll get higher heat transfer. Okay, so coming back to asking the question on whether you crank up the AC or you turn on the heat, what's your thinking now?
Heat.
Okay. So what's the temperature in the car?
-1.
The ambient temperature is the dry bulb temperature. Wet bulb temperature is the temperature out on that surface of your windshield. So you don't get to change that, that's there. But you can either crank up the heat in the car and increase the dry bulb temperature. If you turn on the AC, what are you doing? You're making that delta smaller. But what's your experience? The AC actually does help, right? So is this equation lying to us? What's happening when you turn on the AC? Is it the AC that's actually doing it, or is it just the fact that you're passing velocity over the windshield? Okay, so there's lots to think about here. There's, in fact, the best option in many cases is to open the window so that you can get air out, because you've got moisture in the air, you want to get it out of the car. So open your window and crank on the heat. Sorry. It's wasteful, but it goes quickly, right? So, yeah, and AC can, if you think of it, AC can have some impact over there as well, because AC will change how much moisture you can hold in the air. So, it's not obvious here. Let's take a look as well as an example. If you put air at 70 degrees Celsius, okay, you've got a certain dry bulb temperature, 70 degrees Celsius. Let's take a humidity of 20%. At 20% humidity, your wet bulb temperature is up there and down at 45 degrees Celsius. Okay, so let's make a note of this. So air at 70 Celsius and humidity of 20%, your wet bulb temperature is 45 degrees Celsius. So dry bulb is 70, your wet bulb is 45. Your temperature difference there is 70 minus 45 is 35. If your temperature, if you're putting air in at 70 degrees Celsius, but now you've got humidity of not 20%, but let's take this value over here, 5%. What's your wet bulb temperature now? It's kind of 5, interpolate over there, come back down. You've got about 32, 33 degrees. So you get a larger delta occurring. So that larger delta T now implies that you can take up more moisture. Okay, so it's intuitive, because it's saying if you're feeding air at 20% humidity, there's already moisture in that air. There's less capacity for that air to take up moisture than an airstream at the same temperature but with lower incoming humidity. So it's simply, it's a mass transfer concept. If you've got air coming in with water in it already, it's got less capacity to take up water. Less water coming in, you've got more capacity to take up water. Okay, so that's why this denominator makes sense as well. Okay, there's one final piece of terminology we have to become comfortable with in order to solve some problems in this area, and that's considering dry bases and wet bases. So over here, it's showing what that difference is between a dry basis and a wet basis. The wet basis is a little bit more intuitive. It says take the mass of water divided by the mass of water solids, and that's your percentage moisture on a wet basis. So in this example, I've got 200 kilograms of wet solids, and if I say the moisture is 30% on a wet basis, 200 kilograms times 30% tells me there's 60 kilograms of water in that solid. So if I visualize this 200 kilograms of solid, there's some fraction of it that's moisture. In this case, there's 60 kilograms of water in there and 140 kilograms of dry solid. Okay, so that's my wet basis. My dry basis, on the other hand, is mass of water divided by mass of dry solids. We prefer working with dry bases because you notice in all those derivations earlier, we're dealing that capital X is mass of water per mass of dry solid. So those are dry bases over there, and we're very looking at that. Just one correction in your notes is this error over here. Please correct that. We've got this printout. Okay, so one way to consider the dry basis is, let's take 200 kilograms of wet solids, and if I say there's 30% moisture on a dry basis, I'm asking how much of that is water, how much of that 200 kilograms is solid. Well, what you do is, let's take a reference amount of 100 kilograms of dry solids, and we can ratio it against it. So So 30% on a dry basis is saying I've got 30 kilograms of water and then 30 plus 100 kilograms of dry solids. That's 30 over 130. Multiply that by the 200 kilograms of wet solids. So in fact, I've got 23.1% times 200. I've got 46 kilograms of water and the rest is wet solid. So it's just a different way of expressing it. Now that bottom derivation, it might be one way that you could consider it. Let me write up another way that might be a little easier for you to understand. And it shows nicely the link between the dry basis and the wet basis. So consider this. X is your mass of water. And Y is your mass of wet solids. So then if I said something had 30% on a dry basis, so then if 30% on a dry basis would mean I could say X divided by Y minus X. That would be one way you could say it. And X in this case is mass of water. And the denominator there, if Y is my mass of wet solids, Y minus X then is my mass of dry solids. Okay, which is exactly the definition over there for the dry basis. Dry basis is mass of water over mass of dry solids, or X divided by Y minus X, and that would be equal to 0.3 in this example.
Have you ever think of which one is used, like in industry, they just say 30% moisture?
They should always specify. Yeah, because you'll get very different answers if you make an assumption. Okay, so if we've got that relationship, then let's come back to this example of 200 kilograms. Then you could say, let Y equal my mass of wet solids, so then if Y is 200 kilograms, I can substitute in there and solve for X, which is my mass of water. So if Y is 200 kilograms, I can rearrange that equation, and what you will get is that 30 divided by 130 times 200, and then show that X is equal to 46.2. So you will always see wet basis and dry basis. Books just work with different terminology.
Okay. Right now that's X is equal to 100.8.
Y minus X would be 100. Yeah, exactly. Because Y is 200 kilograms of wet solid. Okay, so let's bring some of these sections together here. If we consider our plate and frame filter press that we saw a few classes ago, like Claudia had a picture similar to this press up here. This is a filter press in Qatar, and if you open up that press afterwards, you get basically what's shown over there on the right hand side. So if I zoom in a little bit on that, basically it looks a bit like drywall. Right? So you can take a piece of drywall. It's similar to what you get out of a plate and frame filter press. So a centimeter or two in thickness and just a big slab of mostly dry solids. Let's say that solid is 30% dry on a dry basis. You'd like to get it down to a lower weight so that you can transport that valuable final product. So that's the concept we're considering in this problem. So 100 kilograms of cake discharged from that press at 30% moisture on the wet basis. We're going to dry it using air at 75 Celsius and 10% humidity at a velocity of 4 meters per second. And that tray holds a 2 meter squared slab. We're gonna put this in a tray dryer. So it looks, tray dryer looks something like that. Multiple trays, and on each tray we load our solids and blow hot air over it. So we're blowing this air over it parallel to the solid surface. So we know which correlation to use. And our aim is we'd like to get to a point which is 15% on a dry basis, so then we can process it further. So estimate the drying time. So there's 20 minutes left in this class. We're going to finish up with this problem. I'd like you to take at least 5 minutes to plan what you know, what you don't know, and what your strategy is for solving this. Okay, so let's work on this one, and we'll be able to wrap it up in 5 minutes. Yeah, so you open up the press, it's a wet solid. So X is a massive water divided by mass of solid. Yeah, so I'm saying massive water divided by mass of solid. That's the definition of Trying to dry a solid with a parallel airstream, we know that it's going to be an equation of this form that's going to apply. But to say that, what's the key assumption or assumptions we're making to use that equation?
We're just operating in that constant
flux
range?
We're operating in that constant drying rate range, and also we're assuming that all our heat is going to vaporizing liquid.
Okay.
and not to anywhere else. So we've got ideal, fairly ideal situation. So those are key assumptions. And if we can say that, then our explore step is saying that T equals delta M W times delta H bar divided by H T V. So if that equation applies, and our aim is to calculate T, what do we need to find? What are we not given yet? We don't know yet. Okay, so unknown. Anything else we need to find? We need our wet bulb temperature. H. And delta H bar. So four things we don't know. We do know the area. We do know the dry bulb temperature. So knowns. The dry bulb temperature was given to us at 75. And area was given to us as well. Okay, so work on those three or four constants, and calculate what they are. Give you another minute or two to calculate some of them. So pick whichever one you prefer to work on. How much of that is dry solid?
30 kilograms
of water. Okay. 70 kilograms of dry solid, 30 kilograms of water initially. So finally, I'm going to end up with some amount of wet cake. I'm not going to remove all the moisture from it. I'm in fact asked to get to a point where there's only 15% remaining, 15% on the dry basis. But that 70 kilograms of dry solid is going to be the same before and after. So my final cake is going to still be 70 kilograms of dry solid plus some amount of water. How much is that water?
About
Okay, so where would we like to be? We'd like to get to 15% on a dry basis at the end.
So we're asking for 15% on a dry basis. That says 0.15 is equal to what divided by what? What's the definition for dry basis?
Mass of
water, okay, divided by okay, so 70 kilograms in the denominator. In the numerator, I could write it as 30 minus delta NW. Okay. So delta NW is the amount of water I'm going to evaporate. My numerator is the amount of water left over in the cake. So I started off with 30. I'm going to remove an amount minus delta NW. Okay. So you can solve that then for delta NW.
I'm doing the numerator again. I don't understand.
Okay.
Because why don't you just find the mass of water? The formula is mass of water over mass of dilation.
Okay.
So like, why don't you just multiply 0.15 times 70 to be the mass of water that evaporated?
Right, and then that will get you the mass of water left over in the cake. That's absolutely fine. But what we're interested actually is the change in water. How much water are we going to evaporate? So one way I can express that is say 30 minus. Okay, so that gives me my delta NW. So that's one constant that I've got now. What's my wet bulb temperature?
It's approximately 42 degrees.
Approximately 42 degrees. Everyone agree with that? Yeah, that's a straightforward calculation. Okay, we know our air comes in. We know that our temperatures of our air, so we can calculate that wet bulb temperature. What is H? Well, let's ask an easy one. What's delta H bar? Okay, so heat of vaporization, it's earlier on in your notes. Heat of vaporization, we know it is 2,500 kilojoules per kilogram at 0 degrees Celsius, and it's a different number at 100 degrees Celsius. So this is the heat of vaporization. We're going to need to interpolate in between those two, but at what value do we interpolate? Okay, so the answer's up there, but I'm asking why. Why are we interested at the heat of vaporization at the wet bulb temperature?
That's the
temperature on the surface where that vaporization is taking place. So if you interpolate the wet bulb temperature is 42 degrees Celsius, it's got to be somewhere in between those two numbers, closer to the 2,500 and 2,260. This is an important number. It's the biggest, one of the biggest influences in our calculation. Because this is kilojoules. This is a lot of energy required per kilogram of water. Water is really, really expensive and costly to evaporate. So our biggest energy consumer here, the delta HVAC is 2401 kilojoules per kilogram. Okay, so got that done. The last one I need is H. Which correlation do I use? First one, okay, so we use the one for parallel flow. To calculate H, I need to know G. To calculate G, I need to know V, the velocity, which I do know, and I need to know rho. Okay. So rho is the humid heat. It's a function of, so VH is a function of psi, and it's a function of the dry bulb temperature. Both of those terms we know. Do we?
Yeah.
There'll be no sign. Yeah. No.
Oh no, that's a.
We can find it quite easy. Okay, so read the diagram and you can find psi. Drybulb temperature we know, so we can calculate dH. So I'll leave that for you to go do. dH in this case is 1.048. Inverted because G needs rho and rho is inverse VH. And then finally the velocity on average is 4 meters per second. Okay, so that gives me my G, and in this case that's 13736 kilograms per hour per meter squared. And then finally we can calculate H. That's 41.7. And the units there are watts per meter squared Kelvin. So there's simple subbing under there.
Do we have to convert velocity to hours first in order to get that? Or does that constant take that consideration?
That's the 3600.
Okay.
Does the seconds to hours conversion for you. So that's why I emphasize that G has non-standard units when it's used in. So, yeah, I've mentioned it up there. Rho and V are in SI units, up in the slide. So notice here, rho and V are already in SI units. Okay, so we've got all our terms now. We just go ahead and sub in. This is the part that everyone loves to do. It's nice and easy. One thing you have to be careful of, is this 2,400 kilojoules per kilogram. So take into account that times 1,000 there, because otherwise you're going to get drying times that are really short. Okay. So once you get all of that information in there, you can get a drying time of 4.6 hours. So a very substantial drying time for that slag or salt. So I'll post this note, this slide on the website. Don't try to copy it down. Okay, so here's a question to think about. Do you expect the drying time to increase or decrease if I use a perpendicular stream of air? Okay, so right now I'm using, here's my solid, and my airstream is flowing this way. Would it be better if the airstream flowed perpendicular? Depends. Okay, so in this case, you can show, in fact, your heat transfer coefficient changes from 41 to 39. So very, very little change. In fact, it's a slight increase in time. Probably because that air is not, that moisture isn't being taken away too much. Then just a final point here. One thing that obviously makes sense to us is we'd like to increase the area of that solid. If I increase that area of the solid, I'm going to get much, much greater drying, much shorter drying times. So one way companies will do this is if a solid is able to be extruded, you put it through an extruder and create pellets. So this is what's in the assignment. Create small pellets, and if you calculate the equivalent spherical diameter of that pellet, or if you happen to create spheres, that's the diameter of that that goes in that correlation. And you'll find that these heat transfer coefficients are about 50 times larger. Okay, so you can get a very big reduction in your heat transfer coefficients. So your heat transfer coefficient is 50 times greater, so you get 50 times less resistance. But also because you've created pellets now, your area is much, much greater. So you get both things working in your favor. And then your drying times go down to minutes and seconds.
That's the Reynolds number of the air.
This is the Reynolds number of around the particle, around the salt. Okay. So work on that one through the assignment, which is due in class.